Because if you're going to hear from God, I mean, he's a righteous God. He cannot work through a dirty vessel. That's why he would say to them, you perverted an unbelieving generation. How long should I put up with you? He said that to his disciples. There were attitudes that they had not dealt with, and so he shows them in Luke chapters 9 and 10 why the 70 didn't get it and why the 70 did. And but boy, there were some seven kingdom-killing attitudes that had to be dealt with before they were in shape to be effective. And so, you know, it all begins, how open and honest am I right before God? And the one who's intimate with God in that way, who hears from God, is the one who's going to be effective in ministry. Simple as that. And that's why I said, why discernment is so critical? I said, do I believe anything coming from a person living an unrighteous life? Do I think it's from God? Absolutely not. And that's the reason. No way. It isn't God speaking through that person. He could speak through a donkey if he wanted to, but a donkey's probably in better shape than some of the people that have told me what to do. You ever notice that? You don't see donkeys cheating on their wives or elephants shooting dope in their vein. I mean, that's fallen humanity doing those things. You know, the nature, you know, heaven and earth is still showing forth the glory of God. You know, the animal kingdom is still operating out of divine instinct like we're supposed to. It's us who've gone astray. In a sense, they still reflect that. You know, they know when to fly south and north. Nobody taught them that. That's divine instinct. God gave them that. Third point. Therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another so that you may be healed. Man, if it isn't there, put it there. I mean, you know, it's kind of then, probably, the effective prayer of a righteous man can accomplish much. But then, when? After they've confessed. You know, now I can show you all kinds of answers to prayer. I mean, look at it this way. Suppose somebody in your church is sick for whatever reason, and they call the elders and say, I'm asking for a James 5 ministry in my life. And let's say you got some really godly elders, and they pray up a storm, they fast for a day, just out of love for this person, and they go out there, and they petition God, and they pray for this person, and only to find out later that this person is deeply in the bondage of bitterness, has had an abortion, and you expect God to answer that prayer? I don't. But Lord, didn't I cast out demons in your name? Didn't I heal? Depart from me, you who practice iniquity. I never knew you. If that to me is the scariest verse in the Bible. You can see manipulation of the spiritual world. I just came back from a conference where the featured star was supposed to be an ex-shaman out of Venezuela, but the crisis down there was so bad he couldn't get out. You ever read Spirit of the Rainforest? The man who wrote that was there presenting.
We were there.
We met him.
Oh, yeah. How do you say that tribe?
Yanomami.
Yeah.
But we met the ex-shaman.
Yeah. Bautista, yeah. Neat guy. I mean, this is a great, great story. And, but, I mean, actually, it's a good book to give to skeptics who don't think there's a spiritual battle going on for your mind, because that's all it is for them. I mean, it's just constant. And but it's not just there, folks. It's all over the world. Well, you know, God has given us a way to live, and then we can violate every way that he told us to live, and we get sick because of it, and God, we expect God to heal us. And all the attention is given begging God to heal somebody when I think the right thing to do is to help this person get back in a righteous relationship with God and start living according to the way God called them to live. Then I think you can expect a miracle, folks. But the only real miracle that you should be looking for is the miracle of forgiveness, the miracle of repentance, the miracle of the opportunity, the privilege to get back into a righteous relationship with God. It's not a negative thing. If we know the truth, this is the most incredible privilege in the world. He had every right to allow us to live forever in eternity without him. But the great news is he gave his life that we could get back into a righteous relationship with him. And if we did, would there be a health benefit for that? I'm convinced there would be. Now I can tell you stories all day. I mean, I've had people come out of, you know, doctor-certified allergies. I mean, one family stood up. I had to show the testimony up in Bellingham one time. She had 200 doctor-certified allergies. Kids had about 100 they could identify. There were places they couldn't go, food they couldn't eat, clothing they couldn't wear. Psychosomatic illnesses. That's what the term that's used for it. That's what we're dealing with here. We're not dealing with broken legs here, folks. I mean, the whole text in James 5 is so spiritual. You don't know if we're talking about salvation at times. I mean, the terms there are really amazing to me. But I said, if our doctors are telling us that most of our people are sick, and they are, for psychosomatic reasons, whose responsibility is it to solve that? I think it's the church. So if the church is working in good cooperation, you know, with the medical profession, I think we're going to see some remarkable things. But that's just a proven fact that anger kills. You know, probably was stimulated thinking was an old book years ago, None of These Diseases. And so I think the truth of it is that if we really love this person and we're dealing with them holistically, we're going to help them get back into a righteous relationship with God. And get back on the path and live according to the way and live in that way, you're going to see some real remarkable things take place. They may have to continue to live with the consequences of their sins, which I don't think God eradicates in most cases. Otherwise, we just sin and go to church and never have to deal with the fact that I've drank for 20 years, now I got cirrhosis of the liver, and I expect God to heal that. They may. Especially if this person did all that before he came to Christ and then came to Christ and found God's forgiveness and freedom, God may intervene at that time. I'd have a little more confidence praying then than if the guy who's struggling with that and continuing to drink and then expects God to alleviate the circumstances from that. Wow. Is this making sense to you? I hope it does, because, you know, I care for folks. I mean, who wants to see them suffer and die? Who wants to see them live this way? But if I know that my God will turn me over the tormentors if I don't forgive from my heart, and I expect this person, God, to answer my prayer, and I'm filled with pride, and he's opposed to me, but we won't deal with pride. I said, deal with the pride, man. Pride comes before a fall, and that fall could be physical illness, death, or anything. I said, to help people get back into a humble, righteous relationship with God, then the effective, fervent prayer of a righteous man will avail much. And I think you can pray with confidence. But not to find out later that this person is violating, you know, everything that's sacred between them and God. And it just sickens me, to be honest with you, that somebody's promising a healing, and they go all these people in the stadium, and then they come up, and never ask about their life, their relationship with God, or anything else, and just somehow or another, I just want a miracle. Repentance is a miracle. Faith in God is a miracle. The fact that I can have a relationship with him is a miracle. It's a miracle. The Christian life, the whole life is a miracle. And the most incredible miracle to me is how God, in his sovereignty, without ever violating his word, operating not outside the fixed order, but the fixed order that he created, and bring all of this to pass. How he does that, that's the most amazing thing in the world. It's not a big thing to me that God could speak and bring something to existence. I believe that. Or that he immediately could heal the warts in your skin. That's an instantaneous thing. He could do that just like that. That's nothing. But how he can orchestrate a bunch of rebellious people and get us to move together and the timing of these things, and it all comes about with and staying true to himself and his nature and his character, that's the miracle to me. I mean, how does he do that? Blows my mind. But if you believe, if you have any notion of God at all, that God can instantly change something, I mean, he can, that's nothing for him. But to orchestrate all of this fallen humanity, so somehow or another we're led and bringing people together and you know, wow, that's, and never violate himself and never change his character. The devil flops all over the place. I mean, this is a tough fight, because the devil, he doesn't have to play by the rules. God does. That's the only reason we're still in bondage down here. If the devil had a character that had to stay true to it, and that was revealed in the Bible, game's up. It's over with. Because you could immediately detect that. But he doesn't. And so consequently, that's why there is never any specific thing that says Satan always do this and he always has to do this. He doesn't. He can tell you the truth for a while, then tell you a lie. How are we doing time-wise? Now, if that person will assume their responsibility, let me give you the classic of this, borderline personality. Have we talked about that one yet? It's the curse of the industry, folks. Ask any counselor who's been around for 20 years. I said, what's the last person you want to see? Borderline personality. Why is that? Well, I'll tell you what they will do. They will come in and hang on you, and you're the only one that can fix me, and you know, and you can't, by the way. And what will happen after you tried your best for 6 months, they'll go off to somebody else and turn around, badmouth you, and then they'll hang all over that person for 6 months. I honestly think I know what the issue is. I really do. They have an underlying belief that somebody else has to fix them. And that's what's driving them. And until they deal with that, they will never get the help they're looking for, because they won't assume their own responsibility. You know, I said that in England to a group of pastors about a year ago this time. And a gal came up afterwards, scars all over her arms. I kid you not. She was, you just wonder, wow, what have you done to yourself? And she said, I was borderline. I was borderline. I was a borderline personality. She said, you're absolutely right. But she said, I had such zero self-esteem that I had no confidence whatsoever in myself that I had any hope to ever get out of this thing. No matter what I had tried, no matter how hard I tried, I just couldn't improve myself. She said, until somebody recommended your ministry. And she went and lived with one of our ministry associates we have over there. They're full-time in another ministry, but actually live there. What got me out of this, she said, was they taught me who I was in Christ, that actually I could not do it in the flesh, but I could in Christ. I started to believe I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And that got her out of it. I said, would you share that? Would you be willing to share that with these pastors? And she got up and said, powerful testimony. She had actually was so desperate, she walked into a mall and right in front of people stuck a knife right in her gut. That's how desperate she was. The scars on her arms were because she lit herself on fire. I mean, this is about as bad as it gets. But she was classic borderline. But the answer is not to somehow physically hype them up. Oh, yes, you can do it. No, the answer is you're a child of God and you can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. And the confidence that you were looking for us was misplaced. The confidence should be in God. And if it's in God and you know that you're his child, and she said, that is the most, nothing transformed my life more than to realize I was a child of God. And that in Christ, I can live a righteous life. I can make choices. And you're going to come across people who think they have a no, they don't have a no button. They don't realize they could actually make a choice. I mean, that's as bizarre a guess, but I've seen that. I've had people tell me, I never even considered the possibility that I didn't have to believe this thought in my mind. Honestly. They just, whatever came to mind, they did it. That's why, to me, the hardest people to get out of that, other than borderline, are very highly subjective people. Whatever comes to mind, they just do it. And it's like nobody has ever, and if you were raised in a home where mom and dad made all your decisions for you, you're going to struggle in your Christianity. Well, you won't personally make decisions yourself. Somewhere along the line, you know, in becoming an adult and to mature, we have to realize I'm responsible for my own attitudes and actions. And I have the capacity in Christ to make the right decisions. If you've got zero confidence in that, then you're going to keep going to somebody else. Now, that's their side. What's our side? What's our responsibility? By the way, I seriously believe this, in a long-lasting way to help this person, if those three things are violated, you will not see the answers you need. If I really love you, I'm going to help you assume your responsibility. And the highly subjective ones was, now tell me again I haven't committed the unpardonable sin. I'm dialoguing an email just today again with this kind of a problem. Actually, he's a very intelligent, sharp kid. But he went to a name it, claim it, Pentecostal school where a man came in and told him all this garbage of prosperity. But the one line that he never forgot is never make a vow with God. And he, when I met with him a couple weeks ago, he had every passage in the Bible where it says a vow. And now he's living almost a perfect life, or he's trying to, but he can't see. I said, your problem is systemic. It is not. If I tried to answer that, I'd get nowhere. The problem is you're living under the law instead of under the grace of God. But I would say, in fact, my email today was to mom, was to say, ask him again in Galatians 3 that all those who live under the law are under a curse, and have him explain it to you. But if he says, what does it mean, mom? What does it mean? Don't answer him. If you want to get him out of this thing, somewhere he's got to make that choice himself. If he keeps expecting you to make that choice, he'll come back 2 weeks from now and say, tell me again I haven't committed the unpardonable sin or something. You'll never get him out of there. That's not the issue. I had a guy one time say to me, Neil, my problem is canonicity. All I could think of was a canon. I said, you mean the closing of the canon? Yeah, I've read 7 books. 7 books? There's 7 books on the closing of the canon? I read 7 paragraphs years ago. Do you think that's his problem? You could argue the rest of your life and never get him out of that. And he'd still be wondering whether or not the canon's closed or not. That's not the issue, folks. And it turned out he had this stepfather who was nothing to him, and so he never bonded. And when you never bond like that, humanly, what happens? You come to Christ, you don't bond either. Christianity is nothing but a bunch of programs and rituals that you go through. And he'd gone through that twice, and had been married now. He's in a second marriage, and that's failing because he doesn't know how to relate. It's just a contract. It's just a thing. And I said, you know, the problem with that is there's no early level bonding. By the way, that's one good reason why I really believe in breastfeeding. I really think there's far more there than just nutritious milk. I think there's a closeness and a bonding that God intends to take place. And Erickson's psychosocial stages of development says bonding should take place and trust in that first 9 months. And if it doesn't, that's why these kids that are stuck in orphanages where nobody cares for them have these major problems in all their life. And his brother was with him, and he had the same problem. And as soon as I said that, he said, well, it's getting late. I need to go. I said, see, that's what you do. As soon as somebody gets close to you, you look for the way out. Out he went. And the other guy said, I said, you want to go? He said, I can't. I'm going to lose my marriage and everything if I do. I said, well, I got to go to bed because I got to speak tomorrow morning. But here, I just gave him the steps to freedom. I said, this is something you can do on your own. It's between you and God. But be very open. Don't close your heart. If God brings something in your mind, just do it like it says. And the next morning I showed up, and he came to me. He used to sing music in a church, but he hadn't been in church in 7 years. He was the backslidden brother. And he came up and had his guitar hung around him. He said, red-eyed, just red-eyed. He said, can I sing this morning? I said, I don't know, can you? I mean, I didn't know this guy, really. And I thought it was worth the risk. Worth it. He shared that morning. 500 men were bawling by the time he was done. A lot of men have never bonded, never had an intimate relationship, and tragic. And so Christianity is just a ritual. It's just a new philosophy that you learn. But you know what we're helping people do? Bond with God. Become a Lord's bondservant. Not a technician, but a child of God. And once you help that person have that sense of Abba Father within them, everything changes. It's no longer religion. Do you know that religion, including Christian religion, is the curse of this world? It's the curse of this world. This is all the war going on right now. It's all religion. But a relationship with God is this only hope. Only hope. Only hope. But when Christianity is nothing but a religion, like it is in Northern Ireland, like it was in the Inquisitions, like it was in all kinds of things. I said, it's the curse of this world. And you can't even blame people for not wanting to be religious for that reason. I can see why I'd rather be a humanist. Because it's just divides. Wars come up over it. You know, spirit of the Taliban. I've seen that in Christians all across our country. Same spirit. We don't shoot them. We just use words and destroy one another. Same spirit. Won't be the Holy Spirit. Can't be that. But look at the results. It's a war of words. James is pretty graphic, isn't it? He said the tongue is set on fire by hell. Who can tame it? I mean, it's pretty graphic stuff. 1 Timothy, 2 Timothy, chapter 2, verse 24. Now, a little prep work here before we look at this. Look at the bigger picture again, okay? I mean, what I've tried to share earlier, I said all of us have to be transformed by the renewing of our mind, but we better check for viruses. That the full gospel is not enough to know you're forgiven. God came to give you life, but he also came to undo the works of Satan. And essentially, you cannot have two sovereigns ruling in the same sphere. This is, in terms of eternity, this is actually the bigger issue. Not our individual struggles, but the kingdom of God and the kingdom of darkness, between good and evil. Father of lies, you know, spirit of truth. False prophets, true prophets. That's the big issue. And now, see, the gospel, when understood fully, what he came to do was to undo the works of Satan. That when Adam and Eve sinned, he became the rebel holder of authority. He became the God of this world. That dominion was given to Adam and Eve and their descendants. But when they sinned, they lost it. They forfeited it. And that's what Jesus came, to undo all of that. And he referred to the devil as the ruler of this world, didn't he? Jesus said that. When the devil said, I'll give you the kingdoms of this world, he didn't correct him. He just said, no, I'm about to take everything back. I mean, it was the ultimate of all temptations to somehow or another, I'll give you power. I'll give you influence. You know, watch that one, folks. I mean, that's Christian leaders especially suck into that one big time, very easily. Well, anyway, so he came to undo all that. Now, how do we understand it? I'll tell you my own journey on this thing, because I've seen people who I knew had spiritual problems in my church, but I hadn't been prepared to deal with them, and I didn't know how to deal with them, to be honest with you. And so as I was learning, I was often puzzled by the fact that there was no instructions in the epistles to cast out demons. There was in the Gospels, but look at what's going on here. When he called the 12 initially, the first thing he said to them when he sent them out, I've given you authority and power over demons. First thing he said to them. When the 70 came back, their initial response, first thing they said was, Lord, even the demons are subject to us. That's what they noticed most when they came back. He said, don't rejoice in that. Rejoice in the fact that your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Behold, I've given you authority and power. Authority, right to rule. Power, ability to rule. And as long as you're strong in the Lord and the strength of his might, as long as you realize his power and his authority and you're dependent upon him, you have the same power and authority to do God's will. I've given you authority and power over serpents and scorpions. That's not snakes and bugs. They're not our enemy. That's the devil and his angels. Don't misunderstand that. Snakes and bugs are not our enemy. I said snake is a legitimate fear object, folks, because they can kill you. I mean, fear is the God-given instinct anytime a physical or psychological safety is being threatened. And that's a God-given ability for your protection. But why no instructions there? Well, see, if you understand the Gospels properly, you're still under the Old Testament economy. And you kind of need to know that, because when the rich young ruler came to Jesus and said, how can I have eternal life? He said, keep the commandments. Is that how you would witness to a rich man today? Introduce the law to him? No, but he's under the law at that time. But when he said to him, well, this I've done, realizing there was something wrong here, he said, well, if you want to be mature, then go sell all of your possessions and give it to the poor and follow me. And all he did was to show him that his righteousness was his self-righteousness and that his security was in things and not in his relationship with God. That is probably universal. But no, I wouldn't say that to somebody today. We're under the new covenant now. And so you need to understand that when you read through the Gospels, that he still, at that time, is under the Old Testament economy. The Sermon on the Mount was to introduce genuine righteousness, which would be a transformation of the heart, not external conformity to the law. Well, anyway, so then, you know, when Pentecost comes, and you see this transition in the book of Acts, you know, which had to be a transition because you're going boom from the law. It's tough enough to get people on the law 2,000 years later. Can you imagine how difficult it would have been at that time when for thousands of years that they have been, you know, dependent upon the temple and that to sacrifice? That's why the book of Hebrews is there. It's to get them out of the law and under the grace of God and teach them the new covenant. And so anyway, there are no instructions in the epistles. Why not? Because it's no longer the outside agent's responsibility. Now think about this for a moment. I've given you authority and power to who? To the 12. Wasn't universal. And to the 70. Not universal. Pentecost, every child of God has the same authority and power. Because we're all seated with Christ in the heavenlies. That's not pie-in-the-sky theology, folks. You are a joint heir with Jesus. You are at the right hand of the Father. And that is the position of authority of the universe. So when he says, go into all this world and make disciples, back up, folks. Don't ever share the Great Commission without the previous verse. What does it say? All authority has been given to me in heaven and upon this earth. Go therefore. Now you can't delegate responsibility without authority. Can't do that. That's management 101. We even know that in the secular world. So what's the point of all this? To this power that has been extended towards you who believe in Ephesians chapter 1, that you're seated with Christ in the heavenlies. This isn't over the natural world. This is the position the church has over the kingdom of darkness. Everybody here has the same authority in Christ. A three-year-old child can tell the devil to leave is with the same authority I can if they knew it. And that's why we need to know this, so that we go out into this world, make disciples, that we have the authority and the power over the kingdom of darkness to do that. His authority, his power. You want to try this in the flesh? You're going to get thrashed. Because frankly, in the flesh, you're no match for the God of this world. And I've come across people, I don't know what better to call it, that were so possessed with demonic logic, there was no way I was going to do intellectual battle with that person. I'm a particularly dumb person, but I tell you what, you can't believe how devilish that is. And I said, boy, you better call up on the name of the Lord right now and saying, you know, get in here. Folks, don't ever treat this lightly. The whole world lies in the power of the evil one. He's deceived the whole world. That's not about some obscure passage in Ecclesiastes, folks. That's New Testament teaching. And he's roaring around like a hungry lion seeking for someone to devour. And I said, the call for us is to submit to God and resist the devil, but you better do that first. You ever try to resist the devil without first submitting to God? You're going to have a dogfight. You can submit to God and not resist the devil and stay in bondage. The tragedy here is that most of our recovery ministries aren't doing either one. We're sitting there saying, work the program works. Folks, there's not a program in this world that can set a person free. It may help you with a lot of external props, stop drinking for a while, but you're not free, folks. You just got a dry drunk. Meaner than ever, probably. And doesn't work. We'll get to that in about a few weeks. Look at it this way. I think our people's lives are like a house. You haven't taken the garbage out in about 6 months, spilled a lot of stuff, never cleaned it up. It's going to attract a lot of flies. And because you're aware of that, you say, man, we got to get rid of the flies. No, you have to get rid of the garbage. Now, I have friends, bless their hearts, they study the flight patterns of the flies, determine their commander-in-chief, get all their names. You know, folks, to be honest with you, you could do that perfectly and not solve the problem. Garbage is still there. And the only reason they're there is because of the garbage. You know, let me put it simply. Repentance and faith in God is the answer and will continue to be the answer. And in this church age, there will be no other answer. If somebody wants to believe a lie and refuses to repent, there's no way you're going to help them. That's their choice. I respect that, actually. We'll talk about that later. But you know, we're not Christian shamans. You know, I wrote a foreword to a book where a lady was got into spiritism. And did I tell you about this? Did I? I think I did, didn't I? And, well, she was a psychologist. She had her master's degree, married one son, and saw something was missing in her life, thought it was spiritual, went into a wrong church, got involved in spiritism for 7 years. They were training her to be essentially a channeler or a medium. And one day she said, I've lost my mind. I've lost my mind. Now, she was an educated, responsible person, but she realized she had lost her mind. And so she pulled out of that, but you just don't walk out of it. The only way you're going to get out of the kingdom of darkness is to get into the kingdom of light. You can't meander around in there and hope to get out of it. You won't. And so she felt, I need to become a Christian. This is where the story gets bizarre. I wrote the foreword to this book, and we've gone through 100 pages of her movement into shamanism, essentially, New Age. And anyway, she saw a television program where a Catholic priest and a Lutheran pastor performed some exorcism. And so she flew up to Minnesota to meet him. And the pastor, the Lutheran pastor, I'm sure knew the Lord if he was doing exorcisms, but wasn't successful leading her to Christ, came down, evangelical preacher's pastor led her to Christ. Now she has some assurance of salvation, but couldn't get rid of the thoughts in her head. And so for the next 2 years, they were in a church, I don't want to name it, it's not the point. But for 2 years, they kept calling up the demons and trying to cast them out and manipulate them. It took her 2 years to realize what they're doing was no different than what I was doing in that spiritist church, trying to manipulate the spirit world for different reasons, but same method, essentially. And see, the tragedy to that is, when you dialogue with a demon, you just bypass that person. That's my major reason for being against that. You just bypass that person, because if you allow a demon to speak to that person, they won't remember that, they're tuned out, they're not making choices. You're making them for them right now, and that won't last. And so anyway, she came to a conference I was doing in Topeka, Kansas, and got out of it. But it really is an interesting thing to me that we are not called, folks, to manipulate the spirit world. We're not Christian shamans. That's not our calling. We're not called to defeat the devil. Why? He's already defeated. He's disarmed. You know, you speak the truth. You overcome the lies with the truth. And that's why the church is a pillar and support of truth. That's why I said, woe to me if I don't preach the truth or the gospel. That's what I'm called to do. I said, we're not called to dispel the darkness. We're called to turn on the light. And all the darkness in the world can't stand against one candle that's lit, folks. And what you do is you just keep lighting the light. You just keep turning on the light. It's as simple as that, really. And the more you do it, the more the light shines. So let your light be seen by all men, right? Be salt and light of this world. Don't hide it under a bushel. You know those passages. Well, what's interesting now is that if it's no longer the outside agent, that we all have the same authority and position in Christ, then it's the individual's responsibility to submit to God and resist the devil, isn't it? Now, when you start looking in the New Testament that way, the instructions to the churches, can I confess for you? Can I believe for you? Can I repent for you? Can I forgive for you? Oh, I can't do that. But I can help you. Now I think you have a very definitive passage right in the pastoral epistles, 2 Timothy 2:24. The Lord's bondservant must not be quarrelsome, but be kind to all, able to teach, patient when wrong, with gentleness correcting those who are in opposition, if perhaps God may grant them repentance, leading to a knowledge of the truth, and they may come to their senses and escape from the snare of the devil, having been held captive by him to do his will. Now, that's not a power model. That's a kind, compassionate, able-to-teach model. What's interesting here is that we have songs, more power. You will not find a verse in the New Testament where a Christian needs more power. Why not? You already have it. Read it, Ephesians 1. I pray that your eyes would be open, that we would know the power that has been extended towards us who believe. What's going to happen in your Christian walk if you start asking for something you already have? It's going to go off somewhere. And frankly, it's a faith issue. You know, I'm not accepting by faith what I already have. That's why Paul prays for two things, that our eyes would be open, that we would know the rich inheritance that we have in Christ, all the wonderful things told us in Ephesians 1. The problem is not that it's not true. The problem is we don't see it. And then Ephesians 3 prays that we would know the love of God that goes beyond knowledge. Knowledge itself, I can give you a definition of love, but you got to know it better than that. And the only way you know that is to know Him. And not about Him, but know Him. So, very definitive passage. What's the first qualification? A Lord's bondservant. In a practical sense, somebody who knows who they are in Christ and somebody who's dependent upon God. This won't happen in my lifetime. Probably never happen in the church age. But I'm praying for it. I pray the day when we will see Christian counseling so different from the secular world that we see it primarily as an encounter with God. Not a technique that you learn. Techniques don't set people free. But to see counseling itself as a Christian, that he is the wonderful counselor. He's the one who's going to bring the conviction. He's the one who's going to set this captive free and bind up the broken heart. Humanly, we can't do that. But he can. And he wants to. But it's like he's handcuffed himself during this present church age. He is committed to work through you and I. Isn't he? I wouldn't have chosen that, personally. I mean, much I know about myself right now and the people I've met around this world, I said, bypass this. Choose some other way. But he's chosen to work through the church. How will they hear unless the preacher is sent? He's, you know, that, so we're his body. The positive side of that is that if he was here by himself, he would be limited to one person. And that's why I said, greater things will you do. Not because you will do potentially greater things than God did individually, but greater things will you do because of the collective nature of the body of Christ. You can be all over the world. Where when he was here, it was confined to his person. Now we are the body of Christ, and so essentially it's potentially all over the world. And since we have the life of Christ within us, we can accomplish, if we're led by him, what he accomplished. It's a powerful concept. But that's the church today. Well, so somebody who's dependent upon God, Lord's bondservant must not be, what's the next one? Quarrelsome. Here's a growth issue for me, folks. I mean, I was ex-aerospace engineer. Math was my easiest subject. I was pretty good at logic. You know, I like to think, to this day, I like to figure things out. You know, I read the bridge column every morning. And initially, I won a lot of arguments. No converts, just arguments. It didn't take me long, thank the Lord, that I realized I was on the wrong track. I said, by the time I got to seminary, I didn't teach the students how to win the argument. I taught them how to avoid it. Because I kid you not, I mean, there are just people who just want to argue. I said, why don't you go out and start without me? I'll be out there in 5 minutes. So. It just leads nowhere. It doesn't accomplish anything. The reason a nuclear physicist doesn't trust in Christ is the same reason your garbage collector doesn't. They don't want to. It's a moral issue. It's a lordship issue. They want to run their own life. They want to do their own thing. There's people going good and well. They don't go to your church because they don't want to stop drinking. They don't want to stop fornicating. That's why they don't come. They know what you believe, what you stand for, by and large. They don't want to stop doing that. Someday maybe they will. And then you have an opportunity. If we could show them the bondage they're in. John Stott put it so well. He said, you cannot pander to a person's intellectual arrogance, but you must cater to their intellectual integrity. Well said. You're going to come across people I mean, it's green fruit. Don't even try. Just try to love them as best you can. I said, but if a pastor had an issue with me or what I was teaching, I'd stay up all night for him. If he's really concerned about the truth, if he just wants to fight me, I'd say, let's both save some time, you know. It doesn't do any good. You get nowhere. A man convinced against his will is of the same opinion still. But a good inquirer, somebody seeking the truth and wanting to know, oh man, you know, I want to know that myself. I'll stay up all night to learn that or to help another person learn it. You bet. So there's a real difference here. Practically, when it comes to counseling, I said, you may find some person coming to, for help that just wants to argue with you. You're going to see what we call professional clients. I had one brought to me one time and said, you're going to say this now. I said, no, I'm not. I'm not going to play that game with you. This dear lady was trying to help this person. She, wealthy mother and father, paying for him to have a friend called a psychiatrist for the last 10 years, getting absolutely nowhere, solving nothing, just playing a game every week. And there are people out there happy to take that person's money and sit with you as long as you're willing to pay for it, honestly. And I said, you've been doing that for 10 years. You're 32 years old. You should assume some responsibility for your life a long, long time ago. You know, it's really fascinating. This dear lady in this church for 6 months has been trying to help her, and she sat there, I'm not going to play this game anymore either. I mean, she suddenly became aware of what was going on. Well, what sobered him up so much that we're not going to placate his little game that he was playing for 10 years and, you know, keep daddy was paying for all the bills, and so why work? I mean, and so he went to down the Julian Center where my friend Dick Day was at for a living program for 3 months and changed his life. He had to cook, had to help with the meals, had to clean up around the place, had to assume responsibility like everybody else did. Just assuming the responsibility was enough to change that guy before everybody fed him, paid his way. Tragic. And mom and dad think they're good parents. We'll pay for whatever you need, son. But we won't help you be a responsible person. It's the key here in counseling is keep working towards resolution. The devil will take you down 1,001 rabbit trails. Don't go there. You can get off on the what if so easy. What about all the people in the world? We're not dealing with them right now. We're dealing with you. We'll talk about that afterwards. But don't go there. It's just a diversion. I said, you know, even secular professional counselors know enough to do. You keep focusing, helping them refocus. But the point I'm trying to make is keep working towards resolution. Keep saying, you know, helping them make decisions that will affect their life. Can't make them for them. That won't work. Be kind to all. Ugh, this is huge. In the book of Proverbs, it says, what's desirable in a man is his kindness. This isn't proof, but it's kind of proof. Ladies, here is your opportunity, okay? If you had to choose in us men, strong masculinity or kindness, which one would you choose?
Kindness.
That's true. All over the world. I mean, everybody says kindness. I have had, especially in Asia, come up, well, I'd kind of like to be a man, too. I said, well, I understand that, you know. But if I had to choose, kindness. My wife said to me one time, do you know when you really turned me on? I said, when's that? She said, when I see you kind to my children. Man, it worked. I've been kind ever since. Why is this the case? You're dealing with hurting people. One act of rejection or criticism, you're done. They won't share with you. I'll just do one thing. It's probably in the book, but this is so fascinating. When I taught pastoral counseling at the seminary, we'd get about two-thirds of the way through the first class. I had everybody take out a piece of paper. And I would say, I want you to write on that piece of paper the most offensive thing you've ever done, the best-kept secret of your life, the most hideous sin you've ever committed. Man, I watched the anxiety level go from 0 to 10, and they're looking around the room like this. I know what they're thinking. You know, I'm not a guru. I'm not reading their minds, but I'll tell you what they're thinking. What is this idiot going to have me do with this piece of paper? You know, or I'm thinking of the sixth or the seventh most offensive thing. You know, under penalty of failure, I may turn and share it with this guy beside me. That's what they're thinking. But I let them sit there for a few minutes, and with the anxiety and, you know, And I said, stop, I don't want you to do that. I wanted you, however, to feel one time what the prospect of that would be, what it would feel like. Do you realize how hard that would be to go in and share with a stranger or a friend, you know, some hideous thing about your life like that? That'd be hard, wouldn't it? Sure it would be. Let's face it. That's why we don't do it, by and large. But I said, this is what I want you to put on that piece of paper. If you had to do that, who would you go see? Now, I don't want a person. I want you to do this right now. Think about this. What kind of a person would this person have to be or not be? Do or not do? What's the first thing that comes to your mind?
Trusting.
Loving. Accepting.
Real.
Trusting. What comes to your mind?
Compassionate.
Something new. You know what's interesting? We don't have time here. But I would take a lot of time, and I would have everybody share what's the first thing that comes to your mind. You know, some would say competence. You know, you don't want to share with somebody who says, oh, man, you need help. You know, that's why I told you. You know, I'm hoping you would help me. But you know what's amazing? I would have everybody share, and I would write up on the board, you know, and sometimes put numbers when it's duplicates and that. Who did you just describe? Isn't that something? That's the most amazing thing. You just described God. Compassionate, kind, capable, loving. Now, here's the bottom line thing in ministry. If you haven't committed yourself to become a person like that, would you now? Because you know what you just told yourself? If that person isn't like that, I'm not going to share with them. And that's true. And then we don't know what the problem is. I said, do I need to know that root issue? Probably. If you want to really help them? Probably. It's like a pastor one time told me, we don't have these kind of problems in our church, and I'll tell you why, because I preach the truth around here. You know, that dear person doesn't have a clue that by his very demeanor, there's not a person in that church that's going to share anything intimate with him, and probably not his wife and kids. And the net result of that is, we don't have any problems in this church. Because I preach the truth around here. Because nobody's ever shared with him. Nobody will. And he doesn't realize he's the problem. I wish I could say that's a minor case. That's a pretty big case. And so what happens is, pastors who are kind of lean that way, they just become pastors and directors, and they teach and they counsel. And people scurry out of that church and go to some counseling center hoping there will be somebody to help them. Somebody will love them. Somebody will listen to them. Somebody won't judge them. Somebody who will accept them the way Christ has accepted us. We'll come back to this next week and finish this up and go on to actually the process itself. Any burning questions? I mean, if you think about this for a moment, I'm telling you what it took me 10 years to discover. So I'm not sure how you're receiving this out here, to be honest with you. But just understanding the role of God and myself and this person I'm trying to help. I mean, over the years, I haven't pointed out anybody's sin. You don't have to. That's what I found out. I mean, when I realized and they're not dealing with something, I said, do you feel this is an issue? Now, some of the dynamics and how we maintain control and not lose it in the session, we'll get to next week. Okay? Let's pray together. Father, thank you for your love, for your presence in this room and in our lives, and thank you for the good book. Lord, without it, we'd be absolutely lost. It's the object of our faith, you and your words, and help us to know that, to understand it, that we ourselves could be transformed by the renewing of our minds. Give us an understanding a little bit of this world we're living in and the nature of it. But ultimately, Father, help us to be dependent upon you and to become like you. And we'll thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. I bless. See you next week.